Good morning. Good morning. It is a great morning. So beautiful out there. A couple hundred of us that were on that beautiful boat ride are bragging about it this morning because we had such a treat out there. We want to thank Entertainment Cruise Lines one more time. I am Roland Lewis. I am the president and CEO of the Metropolitan Waterfront Alliance, and on behalf of the board, the staff, and all the MWA family, I welcome to our 2012 conference. This conference has been a really great vehicle to propel great policy to reinvent our waterfront. One of the great things about this conference is the diversity of folks in this room. There are people from every aspect of the maritime world. There's people outside the maritime world. And the cross-pollination that we strive for is, I think, one of the things we are so proud of and continue to work toward. I do want to thank a lot of folks, but I'll do it as briefly as I can. But there, my board that I serve with, the staff, interns, and volunteers, give them a big hand. You've been by our office at 11:30 at night the last few days. You saw them working and working and working, working for pizza, basically, and I appreciate it so much. I want to thank the sponsors of the event. You'll see them all up in a second, but C-Streak, which is the sponsor of this portion of it, and if I can get the next slide up where we have, there we go, that Tower of Power. You see the ones at the top, particularly the Sims Metal Management, Port NYC, National Grid Global Terminal, and the boat providers, Entertainment Cruise Lines, and Hornblower. They're a big hand for those guys and all the sponsors. Do me and them a favor. There's a whole bunch of booths out there with a lot of information. And during the breaks, please visit them, learn what they do. All of our sponsors, I appreciate it. Now, at the very top of that pyramid, you'll see something called the New York, New Jersey Harbor Coalition. I'm wearing a little tag, it's falling off, but I'm a member of the steering committee of this new organization. It's a campaign to try and redress an imbalance. If you watch the federal budget, which some of us do with horror these days, but you'll note that there are water bodies around our nation that get tens of millions of dollars, Chesapeake, Puget Sound, sometimes hundreds of millions of dollars, the Great Lakes. This great water body here does not get similar numbers. I'm almost embarrassed to admit how much in environmental restoration funds we get. It's a very small amount. And we're just trying to get together, all of you, with our congressional representatives, a great delegation, to work together to try and get a little more equity for that. So as you're walking around today, you saw them on the way in, you'll hear there's a couple of sessions on in the afternoon about the Harbor Coalition. Learn about this effort, sign up for the campaign, and be a part of it. So this conference has a theme. We call it a little play on words. We call ourselves an environmental engine and an economic resource. The idea is basic. We have a great port, and that because we have that great port, millions of truck miles are off the road because we're transporting material by rail and sea. It's a good environmental thing. We also have an environmental engine. As we clean this port, the number of species of fish that are resurgent, but equally important on the economic development side, as you'll see in your program, we point out that there was an amazing bit of economic development legislation passed two generations ago. It was called the Clean Water Act. Now, the drafters of that weren't thinking about jobs, I think, as much as we are now, but they were thinking about cleaning the water. They didn't realize they were reinventing this city and many cities across the nation, because right in this territory, in this real estate we're standing in, is billions of dollars of investment that have happened because this water is now clean. You can live, play, and work around it when you couldn't a while ago when it was a sewer. So Clean Water Act equals jobs, and jobs equal, and the jobs in the port equal better environment. Those things are twinned, and we can have it all, as the old saying goes. We can have both. We can, in this waterfront, we can create great environment and create great jobs. you will be with us today. Some of us, you'll be with us tomorrow, where we're focusing. We have a special session. We're trying out. We're focusing on recreational boating, particularly human-powered boating tomorrow. Some issues are right north of here at Pier 66. It's a very exciting idea. In theater, they have a term called the fourth wall. When you are actually addressing the audience, you're breaking that fourth wall. We built the fourth wall also here inadvertently because of land use planning and industry use. We walled off our waterfront. And what's so exciting right now is we're breaking through that fourth wall. We're starting to get not just next to the water with great parks, but in the water for recreation and also transportation, a lot of other good things. So that, please come tomorrow. So I'm going to get us started. We have a series of great speakers, and throughout the day I'll be coming back to tell you sort of the logistics. But again, I thank you all for coming. You are the reason this all happens. We have a record number of attendees this year, and we're just so excited to have you here. We're going to start off to get us. We are sitting here in a magnificent resource. When you ask people, what do you think about the waterfront, they often will often say, oh yeah, the Hudson River Park, that's our waterfront. This was the granddaddy of the reinvention of our waterfront, and I'm so pleased to invite the president of the Hudson River Park to come say words of welcome to her park and our park. And also I should recognize that she is not only the president of the Hudson River Park, she is a hero. She was recognized as an official hero of the harbor. Mark your calendars, we'll be doing it again on October 9th. So please, a warm welcome for Madeline Wills, President of Hudson River Park.
Good morning, everyone. How are you on this beautiful day? And I'm so pleased to host you and have arranged for this lovely day for you today. Welcome to the Hudson River Park. I say that often. Whoops, this is a little tricky here. I say that often these days because I think there are many of you who know this, but the Hudson River Park actually runs from the Battery. It spirals up, runs out of Chamber Street, and then runs all the way to 59th Street. And it is 550 acres and 5 miles long. It's the longest waterfront park in the nation and one of the largest. And I think those numbers are pretty astounding when you look at the size of New York and the size of the Hudson River Park. The park was established by enabling legislation in 1998. As many of you know, the park is 13 years old. It is right now 70% finished, and we still have 30% to go. We are, I look around you, I see many people I know, including people at the Hudson River Park and friends of Hudson River Park. It's been a wonderful, wonderful acknowledgement to all of us that Roland and MWA has really taken on the issues of the waterfront, the importance of the waterfront, really made it like cream, risen to the top, because the waterfront is one of the greatest resources in not just our nation, but really in New York, since we are so much all of water. But what's really, really important is that the issues of the waterfront really be taken seriously and focused on. We are the granddaddy of all waterfront parks. In my last life, head of development and maritime for the Economic Development Corporation, I got to work on many waterfront projects around the city. And I came back to Hudson River Park, one, because it was always, you know, the place that my kids played in, the place that I knew for many, many years, but also because I wanted to make sure that everyone knew is that although this park is great, it has its challenges. We're 70% finished. We need to go the 100% finished. And after 13 years, really, our resources have been drying up. So what does that mean? That means that we need to put, I see as the lights dim, I was gonna say we need to put more light on the Hudson River Park for getting more capital from the state and the city and private resources so that we can finish building out this park. You see how wonderful it is where the park is finished. Some of Tribeca is finished, but a lot of it isn't. Great piece in the Village is finished, but the Meat Market area isn't. The Midtown area isn't. The Hearts and Yards area isn't. So we really have a lot more to do, and we need all of your help to make sure that there is focus on the Hudson River Park so that we get this park finished, and that we finish fixing the infrastructure on the west side, because not only is the Hudson River Park a great amenity, it also literally holds up the West Side Highway. So wherever our bulkheads are still unfinished, it's very important that we get that done. I tell this story, Roland knows, that last summer after I got here and we had Hurricane Irene, we had a massive bulkhead collapse in 39th to 41st Street. And that bulkhead was literally not only holding up our park, but holding up the West Side Highway. So infrastructure equals Hudson River Park. We are as good at infrastructure as any other transportation project. It's a little different, I understand, but you have to think of it. We are a city of water, and the bulkheads are what would hold up our city. So as we move through the challenges of the Hudson River Park, it occurred to me several months ago that we needed to make changes in our legislation in order for us to be able to really sustain this park for the long term, get it funded, and to be, you know, we are a park that actually maintains ourselves from our leases and our permit fees. And as we understand the costs of all this infrastructure that we have to take care of, we also realize that this was not anticipated in the original legislation. And if we, in this time of great constraints on capital from the city and state, if we are to continue to maintain this West Side waterfront as it was originally intended, we're going to have to make some changes in the legislation that are going to allow us to create more revenue in the park and more revenue outside the park so that we can actually exist in 20 and 30 years. So just a couple of little interesting facts. The Hudson River Park has 17 million visits a year. We have 400,000 people using our ball fields. We have 7,500 school children that we teach about the water and its habitat. I could go on and on and on. But across the street, $3 billion worth of construction has occurred since the park has started being built. 94 new buildings have gone up, and we've created over $1.1 billion of additional property taxes that are actually attributed to this park. So what we need to look at is now creating more revenue in this park from both inside this park and outside this park. So Roland serves on our Hudson River Park Strategic Planning Task Force. We are concluding and putting together our recommendations, and we're going to be looking at all of you for your support in making these changes in the Hudson River Park so this park can continue to grow, be built out, and be the amenity that it was always meant to be and will be. Thank you very much.